will be starting at the end of September on the 21st, an exhibit on the work of Frank Lloyd Wright at Florida Southern University, photographs by Robin Hill. That's not the selected student work, which was originally scheduled, it's a replacement for that. And September 23rd, John Cunningham, an architect from Orlando, who has done some buildings locally that you would recognize, will be speaking. And then this postcard gives you all the rest of the events for this fall. If this is your first time here from off campus, we would invite you to leave us your email address for future announcements if you'd like to. There's a basket right here to pick up business cards. And it's great to see a full house. Is the student supervision on for this, the 19th?
Yes.
Yes. Something that's not on the card is the student sponsored symposium, which takes place every fall. And that will be Saturday the 19th, so we'll be mailing out more information about that as well. So if I might ask Rocco Jao, who's our director of undergraduate programs and who's involved in Jim Adamson's work this fall in teaching at the School of Architecture, to please give us an introduction. Rocco.
Thank you. Welcome. Can you all hear me? Pretty well. Should I speak into the microphone? Is that better? It's okay. I'll just try to project a little. Welcome. Thanks for coming out on a rainy night. This is great to have everybody here for this lecture. I did want to say just a couple words. Preface Jim's lecture, hopefully not to have any impact on it one way or another, but just to introduce him. But I did want to say that when I was a student in school, I remember an architecture faculty saying to me, you know, architects never build buildings, they do drawings built by someone else. And when we look at concrete tasks of an architect, they draw, that's what they do, they draw, they don't build. And I thought that that was a kind of peculiar true but peculiar and relevant to tonight's talk, because we're going to be hearing the presentation of someone who builds. So what we learned from architects who build, or more specifically from what value is building for an architect, if drawing is their primary means of communication, if not their livelihood, we asked ourselves, why teach architects to build? I think in an age of sort of instant communication, texting, working on the computer, in some ways we distance ourselves a little bit from the tactile dimensions of our profession. And I think that the line on the paper or the line on the screen, as it may be, is probably less impactful than it was in years in the past. So I think through building we see that the line represents materials, things that are heavy to lift, difficult to shape, and possibly hard to maintain. Building makes lines real as representations of physical things we would like to be permanent, beautiful, and hopefully meaningful. The building experience for the student brings us to tonight's speaker, who is Jim Adamson. Jim Adamson is a founding partner of the design build firm Jersey Devil. It is known for its commitment to craftsmanship and sustainable architecture. Almost immediately after his education in architecture and planning at Princeton University, he, along with Steve Bidanes and a group of itinerant artists and craftsmen, learned from the sites by occupying the sites and building designs that had an intimate connection to the site and to an idea about materials that I think is unprecedented. In recent years, Jim has done numerous design build studios for architecture students from MIT, Miami University, University of Washington, University of Texas in Austin, even the National Taipei University of Technology. And he's done it in really exotic places. You'll you'll see in the work that places like Mexico, India, Cuba, Ghana, Taiwan, and most recently in El Salvador. So it's a wonderful exposure to design build in a number of universities and in a far range of different places across the globe. The work has also been the subject of two books, the Jersey Devil Design Build book by Michael Crosby, published in 1985, and The Devil's Workshop, 25 Years, a Jersey Devil Architecture by Susan Piedmont Palladino and Mark Branch by through Princeton University Press in 1997. So this semester, he is here. He is in Miami. He's our visiting critic for the School of Architecture, working with myself and a group of students as part of an upper-level studio to design and build a structure for a park in the county park system. And I'm happy to say the director of the park system, Jack Hardis, is here with us tonight. It's Jack here in the second row, who sponsored this wonderful opportunity for the School of Architecture and for our students to have this sort of hands-on experience. So we're happy to have Jim here, and know that students participating this semester in the studio will walk away from the semester with the satisfaction of having seen their drawings become a reality, and with a new appreciation for the gravity of lines on a page or a screen as representing more than life or graphite. Their new drawings carry the knowledge of this experience and how to conduct life with skill, and to have appreciation for those who also do the same. So please join me in welcoming Jim Addison.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you for coming out tonight. Nasty night, but hopefully I can entertain you a little bit. I want to thank the School of Architecture and your dean for inviting me here tonight. And Rocco, thank you for that long introduction. It was an interesting thing. I woke up this morning and realized the date today, if you use the numbers, are 999. It only happens maybe once a year, except for the years of zero. But if you take that and turn it upside down, what do you get? It's kind of mischievously diabolical. We go out to the Rural Studio a lot, and Andrew Friedman, the director, likes to introduce us to his students as the aging rock stars of design build. Aging rock stars. Now, I know I got a white hair, I got a pair of sunglasses that only an octogenarian would wear, but still, we have a problem with that. Kind of blind to the Rolling Stones. Jersey Devil, the mythical creature, has been around for centuries. The Rolling Stones have been around for a few years less than that. And Jersey Devil has been around for about 35 years. It currently consists of Steve Bedanis in Seattle, Washington, myself here in Miami, and John Riegel in New Jersey. And we basically run a virtual office through our laptops and the internet. We also have a network of friends all over the country who are artists, carpenters, craftsmen, and they join us every once in a while when we have a project that warrants it. Our motto, as you can see in this photo, is "Have tools, will travel." We actually, in most cases, travel to a site and set up a camp, either in our trailers or site-built structures, design the project and actually build it. This was an early project. It's called the Silo House. It's one of the first actively solar-heated houses in the United States, built after the first oil crisis in 1974. It consists of three silos that are split down the middle, separated about 5 feet to three connecting hallways, create a clear story of windows above to bring in light and also support an active solar collector at the top. The silos came, they were off-the-shelf silos from the Unadilla Silo Company in New York. Simply put, the collectors at the top of the roof heats up air, blowers are turned on, and it draws that air down and stores stores it into an insulated rock bin storage underneath the house. And then when the house itself needs heating, it will turn on a blower and suck that warm air out of the storage and put it directly into the building. It worked fine. One of the problems was that it entailed a lot of sort of mechanical systems, a couple of blowers, relays, differential thermostats. And we figured there must be a better way. During the summertime, the foliage comes in, and with the overhang on the collector, it's able to be in shade, therefore it doesn't overheat. And that's always a concern for design for anything, whether that be a window into a building or a collector. I'm going to be showing you in and out for all of our projects, some of the site-built structures that we lived in while we were at the site. This one's actually at the Sado House. It's called the Cardboard Grotto. It's made out of bent saplings, and we took the cardboard that the windows were shipped in for the Sado House and sheathed it. And I lived in this until the snows came, and we used it as our daily cookout luncheon spot for the crew. This is Charlie and Mary Lou inside the living area. It's actually quite spacious, as you can see. You can also see the clerestory windows that's in that 5-foot separation space. They had spent 7 years in Tanzania, and they wanted a house that was reminiscent of the circular huts that they experienced there. They also, while they were there, they collected a lot of primitive wood carvings, and some of it was the genre, I guess you would call, fertility art. And in response to that, as a housewarming present, we built them this light fixture, and we put it over their bed. Solar power. This was really not unlike today. I'm talking about the 70s now, where there was an oil crisis. It was the oil embargoes that took place. There were shortages, the equivalent of $4 a gallon gas. You guys haven't experienced it, at least the students, but sometimes you have to wait 2 hours in line to be able to fill up your car with gas. It really changed people's attitudes, and people realized that it's time to wean ourselves from oil, but especially from foreign oil. So there was a lot of innovative work that took place during this period by people who experimented alternative energy. We did it ourselves. I'm going to show you a few examples, and our architecture reflects it as well. But I hope that since the situation we have now, even though the cost of gas has come down, people have short memories. It's an important thing for us to get a handle on this, and I hope that the students today will take up that challenge to make a difference, because it ain't going to go away. This is a solar still that I built for friends who didn't like the taste of their tap water. What's innovative about the solar still is that it's tilted up on an angle so it can be incident to the sun directly. And the reason why it works is there's a burlap bag that's black, and it's wicking the water out of the source water in the trough at the top. You close the lid on it, that's the next picture, and the water vapor, it's heated out of the sun. The water vapor condenses against the glass, and then it goes to a trough at the bottom, and you pull out pure water. We took this down to Baja, Mexico, and it produced about a gallon of drinking water a day from seawater. So it was a pretty effective way to deal. And using the sun was easy. This is Donna Walter and her dog sampling chocolate chip cookies made from a solar oven, a very simple one, a box, well insulated. It's got glazing in the front, and then mirrors for reflectors to bring the sun directly into the oven. In reaction to what we experienced at the Sado House, the next house we built, we decided would be passively solar heated. Essentially, that means this one in particular is earth integrated. It's got the proper overhangs, proper orientation, plenty of insulation. it's got a lot of thermal mass. And the idea is to make the envelope of the house be the solar collector itself, self-regulating solar collector. So you don't need all the active systems to make it work. It's located about 40 miles south of San Francisco in San Cruz Mountains, elevation about 2,000 feet, so it actually gets quite cold. It's got incredible views to the south and west, looking over the Pacific Ocean about 15 miles away. It was a really incredible sight. This is a cross section. You see the degree of architectural drawings that we're doing. Don't get too much beyond the schematic stage. I think I have a point right here. Right there is a truncated trome wall. Basically, a thermal mass wall. It's got glazing in front of it, and the sun heats it up. Air from inside drops down behind that wall, heats up, and then it comes through vents back into the space. It's constantly heating the space as the sun shines. It's also using thermal mass at the trunk wall, so we'll keep on doing it in the nighttime. In the summertime, you can reverse it by opening up the vents and actually exhausting that air to the outside. It creates a negative pressure in the house, and you're pulling relatively cool air from the north. So it's a cooling device as well. Above it are a few windows that are there for direct solar gain, but of course for that spectacular view. We put lenticular trusses on top of the north and south walls made by truss joists. And by radiating them out on a curved plan, we're able to create this compound surface that was reminiscent or sort of mirrors the rolling hills in the background. Well-insulated roof with a good roofing membrane on it. Put in drainage tile and put gravel in the roof, better gravel, and then we started filling it with dirt. This dirt is about 8 inches of topsoil, and we did it by hand because we're afraid if we put a bobcat on it, it would sort of be too much weight to the roof. We needn't have worried about it. A couple of years later, the plant woke up to a herd of cows. Would have saved us a lot of labor. Jim Dempsey was our excavator on this project, and he got to be a great friend. And after he finished up all the excavation, he really didn't want to leave. And so he looked around at the countryside on the property there, and he said, why don't you guys take those big boulders and use those to make the retaining walls that you use to bring the dirt up onto your earthen granite house. We had been planning to make that of reinforced concrete, and would have been very expensive. His idea was great. I mean, he saved us a lot of money. It made the project better. It was really good because Jim got to stick around for a couple more weeks. And I think this is a good example of how design build is a good thing because you can implement good ideas quite readily. You just started doing it the next day. Now, there's one thing we've learned in doing design build over the years. There's a time to use your own tools, and there's a time to rent. It's the time to rent. That's a 5-ton boulder and a 3/4-ton pickup truck. Here we are stacking those boulders to create the retaining wall to get the dirt up onto the roof. And this is the finished product. It's kind of hard to tell where the house is and where it starts, where it stops. This is a shot from the courtyard. This is a shot taken 30 years later. This was sent fairly recently by the present owner. He woke up one day to this profusion of flowers growing on the roof. So it's weathered well. Interior shot, these are the clear windows, direct windows above the trome wall. There's a lot of thermal mass in the house, so the diurnal swings of temperature is kind of evened out because all the heating heat is absorbed by that mass. You release it by time when it's cooler. We like to use found materials. This is a flower pot that we turned into a light fixture. We use that and we the living areas, and part of it really warm glow to those areas at nighttime, reflecting the light. We had the foresight to cast the headboard for the master bed into the retaining wall when we built the house, and we put in three culverts to act as light wells. This is a close-up. That's a foam Nerf ball as a light shield, a gooseneck, and then a couple of tin products from the hardware store that we turned into a light fixture for reading. There's another light fixture on the stone wall made from a heating duct and a heating diffuser. These are Perrier bottles where we cut the necks off. We actually implanted them in the concrete wall to bring light into the wine cellar. And on top of that wall, to the left, you can see those bottles. Those are Allendale wine bottles. We took the necks off of those, cast them into the concrete panels, and then put them at the top of the wall to bring light into the utility areas on the north side of the building. The crew enjoyed emptying those bottles as well. Curtis Schreer from the Ann Farm came down and built the interior walls. How many people out there know the Ann Farm? What? Not too many. The Ann Farm was an amazing group of artists from the 60s and 70s, went a little bit into the 80s. And the most well known for, I think, the Cadillac Ranch in Texas. You all know about Cadillac Ranch, right? Okay. Anyway, it's worth looking up if you don't know about the media burn, house in the century. Really amazing stuff. But anyway, Curtis came down and worked with us to make these doors, and he always felt that a door was a missed opportunity to do something more than just a passageway. So he built this one, a set of shelves for bowling trophies, is what he says. Unfortunately, the client hadn't picked up the sport yet, but it was the idea. This is a close-up of the latch, and made it all out of hardwoods, pinned them. This is a latch on another door that he made, and it's spring-loaded. And you can see to the left, there's a maple strip, and that acts as a spring, so that little roller would connect itself to the daytime in the van. This is our campsite. First thing we did was we moved on a construction trailer. That's where Steve lived. That's where we had our meals. We erected a windmill on top of the well that was already dug at the site, and then we put in the storage tank. And this was the water system for the main house that we built, which was way downhill. We built a solar shower, and that served the hot water needs for the whole crew for both winter and summer. Doug Herr, also from Ann Farm, came and worked on this project with us, and at his campsite, he built this very simple wind generator to provide electricity for his lights. He made it out of found materials there at our construction site. He made those pinwheel blades out of sheet metal and just folded them like a kid's pinwheel. They worked great. He hooked it up to an alternator and he had electricity. This is my house. I live in this one on the site. The armature is 3/8 rebar, bent into the shape, covered with two layers of chicken mesh. Then it's covered with burlap bags that have been put into a slurry of cement. You put it on and lay it hard and then a trowel on a pair of cement thing on top of that. About this time, a friend came by, a local rancher, and he looked at this thing and he said, you know, that thing looks like a horse with two asses. So that's how I got its name, the Stinker House. I lived here for over a year, it was so comfortable. This is the football house. It's actually an addition to an existing house. It's in California as well. And it's located about a quarter of a mile from the San Andreas Fault. So we felt we were compelled to design something that would have a spectacular ending when we didn't want to hit. And it was a pretty amazing site, 45-degree sloping hill. We tried to persuade the client to put a goalpost at the bottom of the hill. He didn't like our sense of humor. Here we are, since we couldn't put up scaffolding, it was really too steep. It was hard even to walk on that site. It's very precarious to frame this thing. Here's Steve cutting up some wood. Here, the football trusses, both ends, both walls are football trusses, shaped trusses. And then we suspended the roof and floor joists between, and then filled it out. This is a finished shot of the bridge, covered bridge, connecting it to the main house. Here's a picture of the crew on the over-exuberant bracing for the concrete floor for the foundation. This is our campsite on the same site, on the only level of that ground, about 50 yards away from the house. My pods, the lower left one, Steve, stayed in the upper right one. We had a kitchen below that. Pat Patterson joined us soon thereafter, and so his platform went above mine. We sort of had an infinite capacity for people to come. Unfortunately, we finished it before anybody else came to join us. About that period in the 70s, early 80s, because of the energy problems we were having and the need to develop alternative energy, the Carter administration set up through the Department of Energy an appropriate technology small grants program. And I applied for a grant to develop this idea, which is an integral skylight insulation system. And I got the grant. Basically, it's a rotational lid that's inside of a skylight housing that has glazing on both the north and south side. What happens is that this lid is also counterbalanced, and it's got a central pivot point, so it can take three different positions, but it doesn't take much of an effort to turn it. So the prototype that I built only required a 1/164th horsepower motor, which is smaller than a sewing machine motor. This is winter day time. It allows direct solar beam coming to a building, and the curved surface of the lid will also reflect the sunlight, so you get even spread throughout the building below. So it acts as a daylight strategy as well. At nighttime, the lid rotates and closes, and it becomes the insulation, retains the heat that's gained during the day, and it'll open up the next day when the sun comes up. This is a summertime position. It's blocking the south sun from coming into the building and causing overheating, but it's open to the north side to allow indirect light to come into the building, and we set it up so that it would automatically ventilate the building as well. So here we had a product that was looking for a home, and then soon thereafter we got it, because we got a commission to design and build a house in Fairfax, Virginia. It's called the Hoagie House, because of its sandwich sort of torpedo imagery. Design is based on the seven rotolids at the top is the major spine, and all the rooms kind of cascade up to the rotolids. On the north side of this building, we burned it. We also installed about 12 wells that went down quite deep, and we used that for earth integrated heat pump system for both heating and cooling the house over and above the passive aspects of the rotolid. This, by the way, was one of the first ones of that variety. Now people are doing it a lot, but we had to get an engineer, mechanical engineer, to figure out how to make this work. But it was one of the first. This is a detail of the pool house. We manufactured the lids ourselves right here on the site. And here we are installing the first one. Here's a picture of it in place, bringing in some stuff up. A lot of craftsmanship went into this house. It landed us on the cover of Architecture magazine. We had some fun too. This is the fireplace in the playroom. We bought a junk car from the junkyard. This is an actual working fireplace. We hinged the grill, behind it is Zero Clearance Healy and Fireplace. So all the stuff about fire was taken care of. That hinge opens up, you start the fire, you close the hinge. Pretty cool. We also hooked up the headlights to a dimmer switch, so you could stand in front of it and light it up. We built that plastic mantle piece as a joke, and then put the blinkers on top of that. We suggested to the owner that we stuff a roadkill on top of that. It's another fire, doesn't it? And since we own the jumper anyway, we took the taillights and we mounted them to the end of the array of the rotor lids, and it gives that sort of eerie afterburner effect to the building. This is a light fixture we built in the weightlifting room. It's called Lightweight. And Steve's hands were the mold for the hand. We engaged a lot of craftsmen in this house. There were 18, besides ourselves, there were 18 full-time carpenters. We had artisans from all over the United States come and help us build these incredible things inside. This is one, Charlie Fari from Washington, D.C., blacksmith artist, and he built the enclosure for the fireplace, the andirons, and all the tools. Here's a picture of the final stuff. Tom Galbraith from New Hope, Pennsylvania came down and built the front door. This is two matched slabs of oak with a natural edge. He dadoed the edges and inserted glass for the two side lights. And this is a pretty amazing thing. This is the central stairway. Tom Lucky from Connecticut came down to do this. And our only requirement that we gave him, constraints we gave him, had to be 14 foot in diameter, and it had to disappear so that you could see through it to see the fireplace from one end of the building to the fireplace. So this is what we came up with. Here's Tom putting the inserts off of the steps. This photo shows that you actually can get from upstairs to downstairs. It's a really amazing piece of art. And this is a picture taken from above, and since this house was for a heart surgeon, kind of has that imagery of Doug Hur and Ian came in on this project as well. He built the bar, and the bar radiates out from an aquarium, saltwater aquarium. It's all back wall, it's all curved, and it spirals into the center. And this is one of the few bars around where you feel woozy before you have a drink. And this picture kind of puts them all together. To the left is Doug Hur's bar. You've got Tom Lucky's stair, which is kind of disappearing there in the distance. Tom Galbraith's door, rotor lids above, and then a lot of other built-in furniture that we make to this place. At the end of that project, it was a year to design it, took us 3 years to build it, and we decided that we were going to slow down again. That was too much. It's too much time to spend on one client, actually. So we decided to go back to our old ways, and this was our next project down here in the Redland, and it was for clients that had a very specific program. Les was a woodworker, and the shop space below. Norma, a writer, she wanted to have a loft above the trees where she could write, and then they'd meet in the middle for living quarters. It's oriented east-west. Large overhangs on the east-west as well, with screened-in porches to protect the house from the morning sun and the afternoon sun. We use a lot of radiant barriers, a lot of natural convection, ventilation from the sockets to the roof. This is a building that does not need air conditioning. This is a shot of the interior. The walls do not go all the way up to the ceilings. The idea is to allow that cross ventilation to go all the way through the space. The prevailing winds here out of the southeast. This house was set up on true north-south, east-west axis. This is what happens when you design a house to catch the prevailing breezes and a hurricane comes. The clients were in the house when Hurricane Andrew came, went right over the house. It used to be pine, rockland, and snapped like 90% of the trees. It took them a couple of weeks even to get out of the driveway. It looks like a lot of damage. There was a lot of damage, mostly cosmetic. Structurally, it was sound, but the inside of the house was breached by broken windows because there were no shutters. And a lot of that would have been eliminated, that damage, had there been shutters. Here it is, rebuilt a couple of years later, this time with shutters and no pine trees. This is another project down in Florida Keys. Back in 1935, the Labor Day Hurricane, Illinois got wiped out. And the Red Cross came in and built about a dozen bungalows out of concrete, 1 foot thick walls. Not very tall, usually about 2 bedrooms, kitchen, living area, for the survivors of that hurricane in 35. Our clients here, this is our first visit to the site, they bought it, but the Red Cross house was way too small. They wanted to put in a pottery studio, had multiple bedrooms, a couple of baths, wanted to have a guest room, and so they asked us to come back and see what we could do. So my next slide will show you what our solution was. That's Red Cross house, by the way, right down at the bottom of the driveway, a little bit to the left, and a carport to the left of that. This is what we ended up building. To the right, you have the studio below, the bedrooms above, connected by a bridge to a vertical tower, a circulation tower. That takes you down to the existing Red Cross house, which we turn into the kitchen and living areas. But up on off the tower, you could go across on a bridge and go over to the Airstream trailer, which we turned into the guest house, and we put that on top of the carport. To tie this whole project together, because it had a lot of disparate parts, we created an armature out of metal lath. You can see it there to the left. It actually wraps this whole side of the building that faces US-1. We planted passion fruit vines below it with the idea that it would provide privacy, pull everything together, but also allow ventilation to go through the house. This house is based on the same principles as the house here in Redland. It's got 20 plus ventilation. It does not require air conditioning. We had no problem inviting our friends up north to come down for the winter to build it. And there was plenty of coconuts for Coco Locos. Here we are building the foundation for the tower. 4 more in place, steel in place for the concrete floor. The clients, being potters, made the dobies to hold the reinforcing up into the concrete when the concrete was poured. When we stripped the forms, this is the underside, those dobies became a school of angelfish. They also made the ceramics inserts at the bottom. Those are holes in the wall. Mind you, this is about 4 feet above sea level in the Keys, and those holes are to allow water pressure to get out of the building if there is a flood. That down there is a pottery studio, so it was not a living space. We were impressed by how quickly nature takes over in this climate. And actually, that was the inspiration for the living screen. Here's a picture of the trailer that we bought to put on top of the carport. It's being lifted over the living screen. Let me go back. Here it is, permanently hooked up to sewer and electrical, waiting for the client's mother-in-law to come here. this picture, and here it is hidden from the inspector. After the matching. Interior shot of the stairs going up in the tower and a side elevation of the tower. Some of the cantilever bridges. This is the canopy going from the tower to the inside or the front door of the Red Cross house to give you continuous protection from the rain going from the bedrooms down to get to the kitchen. It's a suspended canopy that would come from the bridge above. And here's a shot from the beach, the modern studio below, bedrooms above. And here's Beth enjoying the ocean breeze. This is another project that we did here in Florida. Thanks to a firm that you all probably know, DPZ. Everybody knows DPZ, right? But anyway, I'm going to mention this and Andreas, but they recommended us to Robert Davis, the developer of Seaside, to build the beach walkover. We went out and met him, he liked our stuff, and he hired us, so we got to build this Natchez Street beach pavilion. It's a means for the town to get from the town over the sensitive dunes down to the beach. Here's a picture approaching the central canopy at the top of the primary dune. From that canopy, the seats that we have at the top morph into the railings for the descent down to the beach. There's another shot looking back at it. It's a very, very popular spot. A couple of weddings took place there. Great place to catch the sunset. And we suspect a lot of other romantic activities take place there. Enough of the Jersey Devil stuff. What I want to do is show you a couple of projects we've done with students, architectural students, and they're actually a lot of fun. This one is, we did this last January, 14 students from MIT, and I went down to El Salvador. And we were given the commission to design an entrance plaza by a non-profit educational group that had built this school, but they had built these two classrooms, separate buildings, each of them had classrooms in it, and uphill from it was a nutrition center. And they wanted to create us to do something, sort of solve the problem, connect that complex with the nutrition center up above. And this is what we saw when we arrived. We only had 2 weeks to build this. We had an intense 2 days of designing it as a group. Here we are presenting to the client, GIOF, which is the name of the nonprofit organization. And this is our renderings that we showed them. This is a hardscape plaza. It's got a water feature running through it. That water feature also functions as irrigation for the plants. They have planters in there, edible food that can connect it to the nutrition center. And we've also put in a small pavilion as a place to sit in the shade. And here's looking down the hill towards the gardens and living screen that's in front of the classroom that was facing Key South. So the idea is that they grow beans there or whatever, but like the living screen you've seen before, it will protect it from the sun. And the water trough goes all the way down there. So the students, it's a closed system, but the students can take the responsibility of irrigating the plants by just scooping out of that trough that's closed loop system, so it's always running. And mega water comes from a cistern that's uphill, rain collected system. We did a lot of this. We called this boulder wrestling. And we pushed around the site, and we actually integrated them with the pools and the planters and the seats that we made. We also had a local tile maker make these tiles out of the concrete tiles done in a hydraulic press. It's actually a screw press, and it was very durable, and we were able to produce them while we were there. So they were a little fragile, but they cured in place. The pavilion was made out of steel, and the students cut it, assembled, and welded it. Here we are putting on locally harvested oak purlins for the roof, and here we are on top of it after we put the corrugated roof in on top of it. We had a pile of bricks that were left over and were free to us on site, so we decided to use those to make our planters and platforms. And here's a shot 1 week into the project of construction. We're moving along quite quickly. We also had a lot of locals helping us, and some of them were quite skilled. For the water channel that's running through it, what we would do is pour raw concrete into the trough that's been formed up. You take a screed in the shape of a U, and you pull it through the formwork to create that trough, so the concrete gets extruded as a trough. And then right behind that, we took river stones and implanted it into the newly formed trough. Here we were testing it to make sure that it indeed went downhill. And this is a shot, this is a finished shot of those pebbles embedded and how the tile relate to the trough. Here we are, assembled with our friends and the maestros and our group. These are some finished shots I'll show you. These were sent back after we left. Notice the pavilion, there's a hole in the center. We planted bamboo inside of there, and that's to provide some extra shade. All the other planters, a lot of the other planters anyway, have edible food in it. So the students were responsible for the food production, and that was the title for the nutrition center. Here the kids are waiting for school. Open up. This is a long shot showing the waterfalls and the water and sort of the whole setup. This took 2 weeks, students, and two of the students stayed an extra week to work on it, and it was about another week to get it to this state. This is a project we did in Ghana, Africa. Gail Delicana, is a professor of interior design at Miami University in Ohio, really an amazing woman. She traveled to Ghana a number of years ago and fell in love with the country and the people there. And in particular, two villages that were called Abrapo Odumasi. And every year she would go there and try to help out the community and did some incredible things through her commitment and generosity. She also liked to bring students from Miami there to do community service work. I met up with her and the students there in Africa. It's really about a month period that takes place during the summer break. I went there, Amy went there as well. And we built first time I was there, built a reading room pavilion, open air, nice roof on it, but a place so that the kids could go outside and actually read. It was connected to a library project been built previously. Here's our group, again about a dozen students after arriving in Accra. This is our site. This is a marketplace. We were given the charge, because we had done the reading room before, they said what we really need is a marketplace. As it existed, this is the center of town. It's on an alluvial plain. Whenever it rains, that turns into a mud quagmire. And it just didn't work as the spot. You can see to the right, this little stall there. That would be the type of stalls they put up and sell their goods. Most of them barter between themselves, but they also wanted to attract the people going up that road. That road goes up to the Kafun National Rainforest, so a lot of people going up there. So they really needed a hardscape. They needed to solve the water problems, get rid of the mud, and make an attractive place to bring in the people off the road. This is what we built for them. This is 18 working days later. We were able to get this far because we hired a lot of people from the village. And here was our core work group. They became our friends. They worked alongside the students. They also shared their building skills. So it was sort of a mentorship that went both ways. Here we are laying out the building, doing some beginning excavation. We were always under the scrutiny of the young architectural review board. There's a rainforest in the background. You can see the rainstorms coming in. Foundation's done, ready for the footers, concrete footers. Now, the year before, Dale and I had bought the village a lever-activated land press for making earthen blocks. And what you do is you take the soil that's natural right there, add a little bit of sand, about 5% of it, put in cement. And you put it in the relatively dry mix, put it into the bowl, pull the lever, and it creates a lot of pressure, and out pops an earthen block that, when cured, it has incredible compressive strength and has a lot of moisture resistance. So it's a very inexpensive building block. So they stockpiled the blocks for us for this year, this project here at Build a Marketplace. We use those for the retaining walls and also for the footings. Footing form one, the safe on concrete. Here we are ready to put in the columns. The columns came from the local common forest. They went out with chainsaws. They cut. And this is the important thing. Even though you saw electric lines going up the road, nobody in the village has electricity because nobody can afford it. So everything's done by hand. Timbers were harvested with a chainsaw, roughly cut in the field by eye with a chainsaw to square them up, and then they get finished up with handsaws. Here are the columns in place, braced, concrete, slab being poured. Simultaneously, we were working on the hardscape. These blocks we got from a local vendor who used a similar ram press, but this time with a lot more cement content to make these pretty durable surface for traffic. The local crew did the high work on framing. We're going to just take a little tour here. There's the frame of the feet. And this is with the slab complete in the roof on. We built in into that retaining wall benches, tables, and then the covered areas where they can set up tables for selling their wares. And beyond that, I'll show you this. This is, we put tin on the roof, we got up to Cape Coast locally. And I was about to go up there and trim the overhanging edges of the roofing when they had put it on. And they said, oh, no, 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 don't do that. And they went up there and we actually trimmed the sheet metal with the sheds. And they did a better job than I could. And I want you to notice the two circles that are in the plaza, and those are for the trees to provide a shade plant after trees are planted in the backside of our skin. The retaining walls not only directed the water flow and kept the mud from forming in this area, we put in a lot of drainage, it also acted as retaining walls as places for people to hang out. Here's a view from the street. Hopefully, when it's built up, the vendors will let those people off the road to go in and buy something. Simultaneously, while we were doing that project, we were also doing this one, creating a prototypical composting toilet. The year before, when we were doing the reading room, Gail and I had stumbled upon the local community latrine, which entailed a really big pit with logs laid across it, space between them, and we'd go out onto these precarious logs and we'd squat. That was the place where the people went. Didn't have a roof, it was filled with water, there were flies, insects. The actual water that was in this pit was boiling with biological activity. And Gail and we vowed that when we came back, we would try to do something about it. And this is what we ended up doing. This is what we built, but the concept comes from Tanzania. It's called the Arbor Loop. The idea is to build a lightweight structure that can, over a relatively shallow hole, that can be, after that hole almost fills up, you pick it up, move it over a new hole about 10 feet away, pop off the old hole, plant a tree. And an average family in Tanzania, anyway, it would fill up about every 6 months. So after about 10 years, the owner would have an orchard with about 20 fruit-bearing trees. They're well fertilized, and they'll take them care of their nests. Here we are casting. We're using the earthen blocks for the formwork, but casting the foundation ring, and to the right is the slab. Here you can see the pencil rock reinforcing. Here, after curing for several weeks, we're taking them up. To the left, you'll see there's an integral squatter toilet that we formed out of paracement. It's integral slab. Emily, an art student from Miami University, teamed up with a local basket weaver in the village, and they created the lightweight structure. Here's a detail of the thatched roof. Here we are making moving dirt to accept the foundation land, they're carrying it up the hill, and the Wachantins said that they loved it. The Harbor Loom team. At first, the villagers were really skeptical about this. They said, this hole is way too small. It's going to fill up too quickly. But after we built it, and after we started thinking about it and the concept of planting a tree, they came around, and it became a phenomenon, and it became a little bit of a photo opportunity, I think. So everybody was even Gail got it. Interesting thing, a couple of days before we left, the village got together and had a ceremony, dressed us up in this traditional garb, and made us honorary chiefs of the village. It was really an incredible honor. And I still have that costume or wardrobe in my closet, and I'm looking forward to the day when I can go back. All right, this is another project, different school, University of Washington. It's actually, even though this one's in India, it's part of the Mexico Design Build Program at UW. The Mexico Design Build Program was founded by Sergio Calaroni and Steve Bedanes in 1995. I joined them on the year 2000, and the design build program lasted until 2005. That's when Sergio Calaroni went to the University of Texas in Austin. So they something at UW. Though Steve continued an urban along with design build at UW. But anyway, we were invited. This is unlike what we normally do. In Mexico, we usually go down to Cuernavaca and build community service projects in squatter communities. This one was a little bit different. This was in India, and I'll show you a little bit more, give you a little bit of history. This is near Pondicherry, southern India. It's a place called Aurobindo. It was founded by Sri Aurobindo and his spiritual, I guess you would call it, collaborator, the mother, in 1968. And it was, the idea was to create a utopian international city, a spiritual city as well. And the intent was to have it be a city of about 60,000 people. Today, there are about 2,000 people there from about 30 countries. There are about 30,000 Indians in the outlying villages that are encompassed by Bogota. But in the planning, city planning, of this sort of beautiful utopian city with these radiating sort of neighborhoods going out to the center, they designated an area called the International Zone. And they asked countries, or it's an open invitation to countries, to come and build something there in the International Zone. We were the second people to pick it up. We were hired by a group called Oroville USA. And they had a lot of funding, and they gave us the opportunity to do this. So we decided, even though it wasn't doing real community service work, it gave us an opportunity to build a building that was off the grid. And also took advantage of the legacy and sustainable building practices in Oroville. So the design is based on, this is a student design as well. It consists of 11 weeks. We go there and we turn the winter quarter, about 40 students and faculty, really only three faculty and a couple of TAs. We design it and build it. It's based, the design that we came up with was based on the sacred banyan tree between the center of Oroville. So the idea was to create a, like the banyan, overriding roof that didn't have any sides on it, so the breeze could go through, and then build the dormitory. And the program from Oroville USA was to build some dormitories so that visiting students could come, study, and actually work in the community when they come to visit Oroville. So it's really a dormitory is what we built. But anyway, you have this overriding roof to protect you from the rain and sun. We built these lightweight, thin shell, parabolic concrete roof structures. And they're being supported by steel as well as reinforced walls. And you'll see some pictures of that. This is looking out from inside one of the dormitory rooms into the ceiling and through the windows. This is outside one of the dormitories looking up at the great roof above. The walls, as I said before, are rammed, and then we poured a tie beam around the top of that rammed to support the columns. This picture here is pretty interesting. If you notice the trough there to the lower left, that one right there, pretty common practice. Every building there in India, or at least in southern India, that's called an ant channel. It's about 4 inches deep and filled with water, surrounds the whole perimeter of the building, and it keeps insects from coming in. This is a detail of brand earth. Essentially, you set up Walmart, and then you take earth, put a little bit of cement in it, and a little bit of sand, very similar to the earthen blocks, and you tamp it down, and it cures after about 20 days, and it's quite durable. We also use some earthen block made the same method with a ram, very similar to one in Ghana, the interior walls for the shower rooms and basin. This is a schematic showing the red are the four dormitory rooms with a core of showers between each double one. And then in the center is a kitchen area, all of this sort of open air, composting toilets to the bottom left. And a gray water treatment system. The blue thing is the cistern. It's an 80,000 gallon in-ground cistern. And then to the north is a tower where the water is pumped. So we have a gravity feed. And all of this is done with photovoltaics. And electricity for the building was through donated photovoltaics, as well as we also had hot water heaters for heating up the water. Pretty amazing building, and you might ask, how can 40 students build something like this? Well, one of the reasons we could do it was because of this man, Kartik. He was the village foreman. We employed over 100 people. I think it was probably more like 150 villagers to build this thing. So it was a huge contest. That 80,000 gallon cistern was in the ground. That was built by one village by hand. And they'd come out and they'd by hand dig it. And the last thing they took out was a series of steps coming out of the hole in the ground. They lined it with double line brick walls, filled it up with reinforced concrete, and then they actually pulled the concrete lid on top of it. But anyway, Kartik was the one who organized all of this for us. The interesting thing, this is inside the tower, which another group built. And he's standing on top of, those are casuarina trees, which are considered pest here in Florida. But in India, southern India, they actually grow them as orchards because it's a commodity. They use it for making scaffolding. This is the inside of that tower with the scaffolding removed. This is just a quick schematic. The composting toilets at the bottom, you see some pictures of that. Reed beds to take care of the initial influx of the gray water, then out of that, absorption fields that will take care of the rest of the moisture. This is a shot at the end of the composting toilets. The black pipes actually heat up in the sun and create a negative pressure and pull air out of the chambers of the composting toilets for odor. This is down below. A car jack is used to jack that tub up to make a seal against the bottom of the opening in the composting toilet. Now that, when that fills up, you remove it, disconnect it, you put a lid on it and let it sit for 6 months to compost before you put it on the fields. Talking about villages, there was one village that specialized in granite farming. So they actually made the granite slab that the composting toilets were located. Another village makes utensils, kitchen utensils. They steam them out of metal. And they were the ones who made the receptors for the composting toilets, including a urine diversion cup. And so it's pretty amazing, all done by hand. But we hired them and they built it. Here we are planting reed beds on the rainwater system. And these are the bananas planted in the absorption field just to suck up the last of the water. And here it is just about complete. It's a pretty amazing town. What we got to do is talk a little bit about sustainability. On the one hand, we built this incredible building, totally off the grid. It dealt with water, it dealt with energy, it dealt with waste. It was basically a pretty amazing building. But at what cost? We use a lot of concrete, we use a lot of steel, and it was really just for housing, not too many students. It was a big building for a small program. Not to mention the carbon footprint of 40 students flying halfway around the world and building. So we got that. And then you look at the background on this slide, and you'll see two little huts. Those were built in 3 days by the villagers for us, using material that was found within 500 feet of our site. And the night watchman was in the one on the right. On the left, that was our meeting house where we meet every day. By the time those buildings need to be replaced in the back, the material they're made from would have grown back in the bush. So that's true sustainability, if you ask me. But for our practice and what we do here in the United States, I feel it has to be kind of a compromise between the two. Just something to think about. Sergio hired a teacher's assistant, Gabe Reed, to do a video chronicling of the documentary of the design build project, which he did. I'm not going to show you that one. But the whole time we were there, there was this incredible song that was on the radio all the time. It was very popular in India. And of course, we were influenced a lot by Bollywood. We came across a couple of movie crews there in Pondicherry making a Bollywood movie. It was pretty exciting. So Gabe came up with this documentary of the design build project. That's what we were.
Yeah.
by Sergio Paoloni and Christine Wurzelbach. We'll learn some more about Jersey Devil. There's a book that Susan Piedmont Palladino wrote with Mark Branch, and it's both of these are available on Amazon.com. So now for a few hearty words of wisdom. Pretty sweet back there. Stop wasting your time in front of the tube. In a situation where you're damned if you do, damned if you don't, I suggest do. And now I think maybe the most important is it's not who you know, but whom. This is Jersey Devil on the level, probably on steroids. Thank you. Was that normally if you do work for the government owns the patent, In this particular case, they allow us to have the patent, so I have the patent on the road that I ended up going through the process and getting it. But I don't know if the EPA is doing that now, are they?
We'll let you know.
Okay. But I think it's a good thing, and I think the law should address our problem, which is hard to do, but I think the populace has to get behind it as well.
Were you just inhabiting the site during construction, or did you design and engineer these projects on site?
That's a very good question. Very few of them we actually moved to the site and then designed it. But a couple, notably the football house, which is on it right there. We used these little drafting boards with small main lines. Biggest sheet is 11 by 17, and that's where we do all of our drawings.
That's the one that I had in my mind to ask that question, because right. That would be the most complicated engineering challenge. And you're telling me that you designed those trusses in the woods.
Okay, you're talking about the football house. Yeah. Well, we did want it to fail spectacularly. What we did was, and this is what we do, and this is how we're able, Jersey Devil is able to do this by working all over the country. We don't have architecture lessons. What we do is we hire a local engineer and have them do all the calculations. They're the ones that start the drawings. And that's the way we go around. So actually, that football house is supposedly going to stand after the big one, but just in case the really big one comes, it's pretty cool. I don't know if that answers the question.
I was just trying to mention my head. Yeah.
Now it's a little bit different because literally you can do it with a laptop that you won't need to do on a pen. We do a lot of that now. That's the reason why we have a virtual office to do with all the functions spread all over the country. That it? Yes. How do you come? Well, you do that?
What would your advice be to someone that said in this age of technology or people, architects, particularly get out in the field and know the layman that or the laborer that's out there doing the actual work, that separation, that gap? Well, what advice would you give someone that's trying to sort of reach that gap that you have? Get out of it, and especially when there's lack of trades.
I think you're absolutely right. I think you do have to get that experience. Architects need that experience. I think Aquinas said, and I'll answer this more specifically, one way to do it is, in the summertime, get a job on the construction site, that sort of thing. Or go out on their own, the way we did, and just start designing small and working your way up. We started out by doing decks and small seating, good buildings, and things like that. Do it for friends. Basically work for free to get the experience and read a lot of books. That's how you learn. Observe a lot too. That's where to do it. Aquinas said, he who works with his hands is a laborer. He who works with his hands and his mind is an artisan. He who works with his hands, his mind, and his heart is an artist. And I think that it behooves all architects to strive to be that artist. You gotta use them all.